Okay. All right. So thank you for that wonderful introduction and keeping it short and sweet. So we are here at the end of our day, and I certainly know that when you get to the end of the day, no matter how wonderful the day was or exciting it is or how many cupcakes you stack on the back table, most people are ready to wrap it up and get out. So I want to use some of this time to offer, hold on, I know how to do this. I have a really strong voice. It's supposed to be weak at the end of the day, but I've had nothing but coffee all day long, so. But I want to offer a couple of closing thoughts that I think bring together several threads from the day, answer any thoughts or questions that are on your mind, and then most importantly, hopefully, I know in some of the other sessions we had mics. If we have mics in here, it'll be great. If we don't have mics, it's okay. We'll use our outside voices. But I would love for us to offer some of our main takeaways. That's the outline for this presentation. And then when we're done with that, if it's even before the printed time of close, I'm going to turn it back over to Shauna and we can be dismissed if there's nothing further. I'm almost afraid to put this email up, I mean, to put this slide up, because it has my email and it has my social media, and just by going to a room during the last session to just look at my computer, I see that some of you have used it. Actually, quite a few of you have used it, and that is great. No, seriously, that is really wonderful. I love when people do it right in the moment. So if you want to connect on social media, please do. If you have questions for me, please feel free to email. Everyone who has emailed, if you have emailed me, I will respond. And for whatever reason, if I just, you know, didn't have the time, I have from now until the time I get back to Nashville, which, because of the cute airport here at Long Beach, means I go from here to Phoenix, and from Phoenix to Dallas, and from Dallas to Nashville. So I have plenty of time to do nothing but email between now and the time I touch down home tomorrow morning. And so that's great. What we're going to do is sort of end our day where we began. I honestly think all that we've done today, if you look at it in the broad scope, the panel, their messages, so much of it converges on the same takeaways, and in a way that you would think that someone had designed this masterfully. But we didn't have control over what the students would say, and it's not like the institution dictated to me what to say or even what observations to make. But I do think good teaching does reinforce the same message. I think repetition is a good teacher. And so a good way to round out the day is to go back to where we began. Shown on the screen is this image. When you look at this image, it's of a dock on water. I'm from Virginia Beach, the other beach, on the other side of the country. And actually, quite honestly, when I think about any city that has beach in its name, I just smile, because it sort of reminds me of home. Long Beach, Virginia Beach, Myrtle Beach. I mean, they're not all the same, but the fact that I grew up, I count Virginia Beach as home. I attach a lot of meaning and memories to water, the beach. When I look at this image, it reminds me of docks that I saw growing up in Virginia Beach, Virginia, when we would go to the ocean. If you look at this dock, you would assume, oh, how beautiful, I hope. You might also look at it and assume that that dock is there on its own. In fact, the design of this dock was intentionally created so that you wouldn't understand or see or notice or even think about the supports and the structures, the things that are underneath it. You look at the beauty of this image and you think dock, water. But in fact, we know that that dock is standing on beams. Lots of beams. Tall beams. The reality is this: in most bodies of water, the bed of the body of water is not even. So most beams are not like this. I mean, you look at this and you think, oh my gosh, those are even. They're actually not even. When you look under the water, you realize that there are things that level them out. Some of the beams are taller. Some of the beams have to be longer because they have a further way to reach down. The entire dock, that beautiful dock that we saw, could not stand there, look like it's resting there, if it wasn't for all of these supports and all of these things. And all of that is under the dock, and there are different lengths and different widths and different places. And in many ways, this is our conundrum when we start thinking about student achievement. When students come into the classroom, most days they look like this. And when you see them in your office or during class or after class, what we have to realize is that within or underneath all students are supports and structures. Some students have benefited from these supports and structures. Some students are oppressed by the things that are underneath that create disadvantages, systemic disadvantages for them. And that most of what we do in this society strives for equality, that is, giving everybody about the same thing. But you could imagine that if you were to do that, for some students who have further to reach or further to travel or didn't attend schools that were schools where college was the aspiration of most students, college-ready schools is what we call them. They didn't attend. You know, I remember once living in Knoxville, Tennessee, and I did had a grant from the state to look at inequities in schools. And, you know, in the same city, not even that far from each other, some students were in classrooms in schools where most teachers, in fact, virtually all teachers, were teaching within their field, had a license to teach, not a provisional license, a license to teach in that field, and most of them had an advanced degree in that area. And just down the road was another school where students were learning from teachers like me. I did teach in the public school school for 1 year. That's all I could survive. My grandmother did 54. I did one. And I was in a public school in Prince George's County, Maryland. And I remember when the story goes like this. I finished my master's at the University of Virginia. I was the fun-sized African-American male with big hair. I had hair on the side, too, then. I thought it was really cool. And I remember I thought, oh, my gosh, I got this job in D.C. And what African-American male in his early 20s wouldn't want to live in D.C.? I was so excited. I did exactly what most people who are fresh out of grad school, no experience but a cool haircut, would do. I bought a brand new car. Why? Because I thought, I'm going to be in D.C. I got this fancy job. I'm making all this money. I was making $35,000 a year. And so I got a new car, a new sports car, because I thought, well, by the time my boss gets to know me, they're clearly going to promote me, like, overnight, probably to, like, vice president. And I would hate for the president to be like, hey, take me to lunch, and I got to put them in a trifling car or a shiftless car or an ugly car. So I was like, I got to have a nice car. So I got a brand new car. Then I thought, I got this big job and this fancy salary, $35,000. It was the most amount of money I've ever made in my entire life. And I remember my mom telling me something that revealed my social class, not at the time, but I'm saying later when I think back to it. I told my mom and dad, oh my gosh, I got this job in D.C. Look how much I'm making. And my mom and dad said, you make more than us. And I remember thinking, education pays off. And so I went to D.C. with my brand new car, and I was like, oh my gosh, I need new clothes because I can't go into my old job with my old clothes, right? So I went to not Barnes and Noble, although I should have probably gone to Barnes and Noble. I went to Banana Republic to get clothes. And so I bought all these clothes that I couldn't afford, and I got a brand new car, and I got me a nice apartment in Bladensburg, Maryland. I still remember to this day my rent was $1,350 a month. But I had $35,000, so I had a lot more money than that. I had $35,000, I only needed $1,350 per month, so I thought I could do it. And I started this job, and I realized very quickly I was living way beyond my means. And then this other cool thing happened, because it does happen to people. With all my hair and all my new clothes and my brand new car, I went to work at this place in D.C. And then I was sitting in the meeting when the president announced that because of financial problems, they were going to downsize. And I thought, downsize, is that like a joke about my height or something? I don't know what that means, downsize. They didn't teach me that in grad school. Downsize. So I Google it, downsize. Oh my gosh, somebody's gonna get fired. And she said, I'll never forget it, we're gonna start with our newest members first. And I remember thinking, like, looking around the room, like, newest members. Who's our newest members? I don't even know who our newest members are. Poor newest members. I feel so bad for the newest members. And by the time I got back to my office, I realized I relive it every time. I go back to my office, I realize I'm the newest member. So now I'm unemployed with the new car and all these new clothes, living in a place I do not know anyone. And it's not a city that you can sort of keep up very easily without an employment. So I packed up my belongings, a little bit of my dignity, and then I left. I put my box of materials in the car that I can't afford, and I broke down into tears. And I thought, I'm unemployed and I'm crying. I don't know what to do. So I do what most unemployed people do in the middle of the day. I went to Starbucks. And so I'm at Starbucks and I'm sitting here, I'm fighting back tears, literally. And this angel, so I'm standing in line to pay for coffee that I cannot afford. And this man turns to me and he says, "Hey, you look really, you know, dapper. What do you do for a living?" And I said, When I got up this morning, I just lost my job. You know, I'm crying my eyeballs out. And he said, "Hey, calm down. It's going to be okay. Do you have a degree?" I said, "Yes, I have a degree and a master's degree." He said, and I quote, "Oh, then call the school system. They'll take anybody." And like that, I turned, I got my coffee, I turned back around, that guy was gone. I thought he was like an angel that just like dropped down, offered this advice, and then left. And I did. I called the school system, and I remember talking to someone in human resources who said, "Hey, do you have a license to teach?" I said, "No." They said, "Do you want one?" I said, "No, not really. I have a driver's license already." And so they said, "Well, what about a degree in education?" I said, "No, my degree is in education policy, if that counts." They said, "Well, did you have any teaching experience?" I said, "Yeah, I was a substitute teacher for a few days during undergrad." And they said, "Okay, well, so let me ask you this. Did you take any courses in undergrad or in your master's program in instruction or curriculum or classroom management?" I said, "No." They said, "Okay, I have the perfect school for you." And they placed me in what they described as a predominantly minority school. But what it was when I got there was almost exclusively black. And when I went to the school, I was the music teacher and kind of like the science teacher and the math teacher, if you can imagine doing all that. And it happens in schools like this all over the country, right? So I go into the school and I look at my classroom. My classroom's so big, I'm so little. And so I kept thinking, what am I gonna do with all this space and how am I gonna make, and you know what I did? I guessed at it for a year and I was no good at it. And students didn't like me. They liked me as a person, but they found my class just way too flexible and way too free. And contrary to popular belief, most young people actually do want structure imposed on them. And people whose lives are chaotic find safety in well-structured classrooms. When your life is out of control, there's nothing better than coming into a classroom where there's order and where you know the rules. So if you're an instructor who enforces rules and offers rules and sets order in your classroom, you're not just doing good teaching, you're also providing structure and order and calm in your students' life when sometimes life is nothing more than chaos. And I didn't know any of that stuff. I can say it now, but I didn't know it then. So students were throwing staplers and all this stuff at me. I'm like ducking and diving, and I just got tired of fighting for my life. So I resigned at the end of 1 year. But looking back, I realized that I thought for some reason this school was like an experiment. But it turns out lots of students go to schools like this, where people are teaching outside their field, unprepared to teach. And interestingly enough, they make their way to Long Beach City College. They make their way to my former institution, The Ohio State University. They make their way, literally have to find a way. But we get them. We all get them. Students who are, you know, we would call them, they're not academically prepared, academically underprepared. But it's not like the student woke up one day and said, "I want to be underprepared." It's because the way their school was structured, it was the HR professional who gave the guy who was unemployed a chance. But I used to live in the state of Tennessee. I now live back in the state of Tennessee. Tennessee did a study back in the 90s called the STAR study. What they found from that is 1 year, with a bad teacher. Bad teacher is operationalized, measured as a teacher who's teaching outside the field in which they're trained. A teacher who does not have a license to teach, a teacher who has not come through a teacher prep program. In K-12, 1 year with a bad teacher, it takes the average student 3 years to recover. Now, as we open up access for first generation and low income and other vulnerable populations and minority students and students living in rural and urban settings, just imagine how many years it's taking our students to catch up. They arrive at Long Beach City College still trying to catch up with the deficits that accumulated because of K-12. And they arrive, and we tell them, we're going to provide them, if nothing else, equitable learning and achievement. We here, and I gotta tell you, I've seen lots of campuses. Not every campus has as its mission statement to provide equitable learning and achievement. But by saying yes to being part of this campus, we are now all connected to this commitment to provide that student, the one I just talked about, who's accumulated all these deficits, not on their own, because of society, because of racism and sexism, because of teaching outside of fields, because of, you know, I was in a school once in a state and realized in 2016 that students were studying from textbooks that were dated the 1980s. The problem with that is society has changed. The world has changed since the 1980s. So they could master that book and still graduate behind and show up in our classrooms. And we said, no matter what, we will provide equity. We'll create it. So to me, providing equity in learning and achievement requires the kind of strategies I've heard all day long. And you've heard them too, through the presenters, and round of applause for all of our presenters and the sessions. But to simply affirm the things that I heard and know is that when we start working on providing equitable student learning and achievement, what we actually are also doing is helping ourselves achieve our mission. When, as an instructor, you use diverse pedagogies, multiple strategies for teaching, if you're a person who knows that you love to talk, present company included, and you sometimes force yourself to stop talking so that discussion and debate can happen, or if you know that you like to maximize the time in the classroom, so you provide a forum through a course management system for students to offer to debate and discuss, when you are a person who intentionally uses videos to convey the message that you're sharing through lecture or to affirm the message from the reading, when you do what I call the cultural audit of your curriculum, as I said in the session over there, where you figure out what's the race of your curriculum. I'm not talking about the whole degree program. I'm talking about in your class, what's the race of your curriculum, the content you're teaching? What's the gender of your curriculum, the predominant gender? Who is reflected in the content that you often use and the examples that you use in class? And who's not there? Who's missing? And how can you start to develop a rhythm and a pattern for using examples in videos and speakers and readings that reflect the diversity of the students in your classroom? How might we better use faculty meetings or instructional learning time where we come together and say things like, hey, you know what? I'm really looking for a video that centers a Muslim student. Anybody have any suggestions? Anybody know where I can look? Okay, well, just know that's on my mind. I really think it's important for me to include all students. I remember sitting in New Jersey at dinner across the table from I was giving a talk on a campus, and I was across the table from a faculty member who's in, he teaches a film class. He has taught the same film class for years, years and years and years. Well, it just happens, and it will happen to all of us, that one semester, he happened to have all women in his class. And virtually all of them were women of color. And it wasn't until I came to his campus to speak, and we're at dinner at an Italian restaurant. It seemed really, really nice because it had like cloth napkins. We're sitting there eating at this Italian restaurant. And I remember he was looking at me and he just broke into tears, and I thought, I didn't even say anything yet. And he said, no, I'm just thinking about what you shared earlier, and I've been sitting here hiding this from, you know, everyone all day, but I got to tell you, you really provoked me when you spoke, because you helped me realize that I'm teaching this film class, and every single year we watch, and he named all the film. I don't know all of them, but he named them. He said, and in not one single film is there a woman of color lead actress. And if you had not come, I would have delivered the class the same way I've always done it. He said, but it just made me think, with all these women of color in my class, they've got to want to see themselves reflected in these films. He said, can I be honest with you, Dr. Strayhorn? I don't know what film has a woman of color as a lead actor. So before you know it, people at the table are having conversations, giving him all sorts of recommendations. And I only gave him one piece of advice. I said, you know, I think you should definitely, you know, incorporate a movie where students will see themselves reflected. But if you are comfortable, I would encourage you to share that story with your students. Let them know, this is how I came to make this decision. And here's how I got the ideas for this. Well, the second edition of the Belonging book comes out this summer. This is not a plug for the book, but in the second edition of the book, I have a pen pal relationship with this professor who I talk about. I tell that part of the story, but then I tell the end of the story. That is, he goes to the classroom and tells them, look, I was about to teach this class the same way I've taught because I didn't even realize, you know, really who was in the classroom. But then I heard the speaker and it led me to change this way. I got these videos and so I'm gonna change it and we're gonna watch this. When he started talking, all of the students were like, yeah, I mean, hello, we were sitting here. He discovered that every single week they were having this conversation, like, does he not even realize that we are in the classroom? Does he not think that we would want to see ourselves in one of these films? I've never even seen these pictures before. I don't want to see these pictures anymore. Before you know it, by being vulnerable, he opened up a point of connection for him and his students. And not only that, they said that the film that his colleagues suggested at dinner are not the only ones. They know some too. And he allowed them to make choices and have input into the course. So now he's not only leveled the playing field in terms of equity, he's also leveled the plane between instructor as producer of knowledge, all-knowing fount of everything, and the student being this, you know, empty vessel in which we pour, but students are actually instructors themselves. It's only when we get so comfortable with ourselves and our roles that we can open up the space where they can teach us stuff. Before you know it, we are both consumer and producer of knowledge. Okay, so when we do this, we're actually doing more than just good teaching. We're fulfilling our mission. When we strive to eliminate knowledge gaps, there are gaps between all of us in this room in terms of our knowledge of things. I could probably start talking. Okay, so I was a music major. I say this all the time. It reflects the comment of one of our colleagues in the room who was in the other session who talked to us about, he was making the point about the curriculum being very white. And most curricula are very traditional, very white. They won't become more diverse until we intentionally diversify them. Said differently, you know, it's hard for us to produce the creative learners that the workforce needs when we're drawing on very traditional curriculum and content. We've got to energize the curriculum to produce creative learners. I'm a music major. I say all the time, I was way more creative as a musician before I majored in music. Because when I didn't know anything about music, I would go to a piano, I would sit down, I'd just experiment, I'd try stuff, I'd be like, oh, I don't know what this is, I don't know what this is, boom. And if it sounded great, I'd be like, yes, I am something really, really important. I'm like Elton John. You know, probably not. Maybe Billy Strayhorn, who's in my family, right? So I play around with keys and I'd be like, yes. And if it sounded horrible, I just tell myself, don't ever do that again. But it was not until I majored in music and a professor told me that the one chord goes to the three chord and a three goes to a five. And if you're jazzy, a five can go to a seven. But it is unresolved in the music world unless it goes back to the one. No one in my graduate program or in my undergraduate program taught me about the two and the four. By a show of hands, how many of you in here have ever heard of John Legend? John Legend is famous because of the two and the four. Said differently, I could have been John Legend if I had not majored in music. Well, actually, the seriousness of this is, how can we make sure that as we deliver the curriculum, the content, we can preserve the creativity, the innovation, the imagination of students? It's a terrible thing to say that you were more creative as a musician before you majored in theory of music. But theory of music should not smash out the creative juices that flow through all of our students. When we start to strive in our classrooms to eliminate knowledge gaps, when we strive to get rid of privileged language that everyone couldn't attach themselves to. I remember I was in, I told you, I taught in Prince George's County in Maryland. And so when you're not the music teacher and the science teacher and the pinch hitting math teacher, on test day, you're the test coordinator, turns out, in the school. So I'm the test coordinator in the school as well. And students had to take what was called the MISPAP, or it's like the Maryland Standardized Test of Performance or something. So part of this test required students to use words in sentences that would demonstrate their understanding of the word. I will never forget it. One year, when I was at this school that will still go unnamed until it slips up and comes out of me, but I was at this school, the word on the exam was joint. Now, if you know anything about PG County, Maryland, which is really close to DC, my school was 99.7% free and reduced lunch. There was one Asian kindergartner who was not on it, but everybody else in the school was. Everyone else was African American. It was the first time. I know for those of you who are veteran, experienced teachers, you will understand this. I'm not. I mean, it was the first time I had ever, you know, seen mental health issues, and I was in an elementary school. Mental health issues show up every day in kids in elementary school. It was the first time I had, you know, meaningful conversations with students about the impact of divorce on their ability to perform well and stay focused in school. It was the first time I ever met a kindergartner who could cuss like a sailor. And on this exam, they had to use the word joint in a sentence. And because I'm the test coordinator, I just decided to flip through the exam at the end of the day and see exactly how well our students were doing. And certainly you had students who would talk about going to the doctor and the doctor examining the joint on their arm or the joint in their elbows, or that the, you know, grandmother complained because of squeaky and cracky joints. But you would have many more students who would say, I saw the man standing on the corner smoking a joint. Which, according to the Educational Testing Service, would be counted wrong. That is not an appropriate way of using that term in a sentence. But actually, when you step into the world of my students, it is probably the most popular and frequent way that they will ever hear that word used. What does it mean to be a student whose worldview, your language, the way in which language is deployed, is judged as wrong in this new context that you're a part of? When we strive to get rid of that kind of those privileged language, when we offer students lexicons, the words that we want them to use, and we train them in the, we offer them readings that reinforce the proper use of it in this new context, we are actually striving to meet our mission. We are making learning more equitable. And then lastly, when we provide assistance and support to students when and where they need it. And you heard it in the students on the panel who talked about, who could name all of the folks who have impacted them. You know, I was so tempted to grab the mic to call out something that was pretty obvious to everyone in the room, and I think to our panelists as well. Students do not hate group work. And they even said it. And there's nothing you can do to change it. There's nothing you can do to make it better, because students don't hate group work. What students don't like, and they said it, from the one on the end whose name was? Gus. What they don't like is they don't like irresponsible peers. When they are in groups with people who don't deliver on what they promise to do, that's what they're frustrated with. It's not the group concept. Or if everybody in the group was responsible and did their part, you could like it. They also don't like being in groups where people start operating according to clicks, and it's just, I wanted to fall on the floor, except I would have messed up my dessert. You know, because I could hear their words echoing so many of the same sentiments. Students don't like to feel lonely. They don't like to feel judged. They don't like to feel isolated. And groups are interesting because if left to our own devices, when you tell us to get in groups, students will start, it'll look like a group, but it won't actually be a group. Because someone's idea will be excluded or voted down or outspoken or, you know, overpowered. And that is what students don't like, is when their ideas don't matter, they feel lonely, looked over, judged in a group. It's not the group effect, but when we provide assistance and support, when we help students create groups that are functional and inclusive, not only is that good teaching, it helps us raise achievement for our vulnerable populations and sustain achievement for our majority populations, which will ultimately reduce the gap and help us fulfill our mission. All right. And then when we provide feedback, and we talked about that in one of my other sessions. So here's what I think we should do. Anything we can do to help students perform, believe in themselves, learn how things get done, will increase achievement, reduce gaps, and fulfill the mission. One thing, you know, how many of you in here have ever told a student, come see me, like during my office hours, or talk to me, and they never came? Yeah. So here's what I learned. Students sometimes don't come to office hours or to meet with us because they don't know what to do when they meet with us. They have no idea. Like, have you ever been so confused you don't even know what your question is? There are so many students who are so confused, so lost. One, they don't know what their question is, and they certainly don't want you to know that they don't even know what their question is. So one of the tools that we started to develop, what we developed a couple years ago, is this. It's have you ever, remember Mad Libs growing up? It's like put a noun here, put a verb here, you read it, and it reads as a funny little statement. We created these things called higher ed libs that are like phrasal scripts for students. We have one that is for office hours. It literally is a script. My son, who's now a teenager, he used to say to me, yeah, my friend's dad is so cool. He's a doctor. And I'm like, well, I'm a doctor. He said, yeah, but not a real doctor. And I said, well, what would make me a real doctor? He said, if you wrote prescriptions. So in honor of this, I wrote this prescription for office hours, higher ed libs, and it gives students phrases to come to us and say things like, hello, my name is, I'm in this class of yours, I have these questions, and it coaches them through how to form a question, how to ask probes, how to ask for help, you know, what YouTube video might I search. So you can take a picture of this, or if you just hit me up on social media or send me an email and say, hey, would you send me the higher ed lib? Then we will send back to you the PDF of this full document. What I think is really great is my former institution actually embedded it in the information they sent to all incoming first year students. I've also heard from faculty who embed it in their syllabus under the part where, hey, I have office hours, and just in case you don't know how to do it, here's a little link to a tool that will help you. This will help students access office hours, which will ultimately, we hope with our support, increase achievement, reduce gaps, help us provide equitable learning, right? And then lastly, we have all sorts of tools about, most students, I said this earlier, that students come to college, you know, that stand right on the periphery of the campus, with all sorts of doubts and anxieties and vulnerabilities and worries. And then they come in and they do one of two things, what we call in psychology pluralistic ignorance. It is the idea that I'm the only one experiencing what I'm going through. It is the most typical response for anyone who is facing, air quotes, hard times. You know, the person who gets fired, goes to Starbucks and feels like they're the only person who's ever been, not fired, I was not fired, I was dismissed because of a downsizing. But and no matter what, I was unemployed. And the person who is unemployed always feels like they are unemployed. The only person unemployed, everybody's got a job but me. Turns out there are a lot of people who don't have jobs. Doesn't make the experience any less frustrating or critical, but this idea that I'm the only. Every student who fails a quiz always believes they're the only one in the class who fails the quiz. That's why when they fail it, they hide it, because they don't want anyone else to know. But actually, there are other people in the classroom who failed the quiz or failed the test. I so appreciated the way in which Tyree framed his experience in math, that it extended his time here at Long Beach City College, right? And I met lots of people who math has extended their time in college, whether it's a community college or a four-year school or grad school or a doctoral program for that matter. But this it's this idea that I'm the only. And what we can do as instructors, which turns out to really help students, is to normalize their beliefs about that. When we say things like, well, you heard it in the students. When we say things like, oh my gosh, please, I struggled with math. I remember the first day I told a student that I have writer's block sometimes. They said, you have writer's block? But you have so many publications and so many books. And I'm like, yeah, and I still got writer's block. And I go to the grocery store to get food. And I fall down in my house. I mean, because students have these expectations of us that we're like super people. They don't really tell us this. But it's why if you've ever seen a student outside of campus, they're like, oh my gosh, I didn't know you lived in the earth. And it turns out we do. And that's great. They have high expectations of us. That's how it's revealed. When we show up at the local fair or in the grocery store or at church, they're like, oh, I didn't expect to see you here. I thought you lived at like instructor world. That's why we owe them high expectations in return. They believe the world of us. Even if they're not showing up to class and they're not following through on assignments, they really do, under it all, have great respect for us. And we should give the same to them. By the same token, we should help them realize that just because we're standing here doesn't mean we've been perfect in education. Students always believe, if you're a professor or an administrator, it must mean you breeze through school. The best thing we can do is tell them, not bleed all over them about these things and say, oh, my life has been so hard, but to help them understand that you faced academic struggle and you overcame it. And if you don't want to talk about yourself, let them know about the last student who faced struggle on the quiz and still got an A on the test. What it does for them is it just says, oh my gosh, I'm not alone in this, and I can still recover and still succeed. And this idea is actually embedded in what's on the screen. This is what we call stinking thinking, this idea that, oh my gosh, I'm gonna fail. And by the way, students who tell themselves they're gonna fail likely do. Students who tell themselves they're not gonna get through your class typically don't. Students that say, I'll never finish this degree have a harder time finishing their degree than students who say, I can do this. And hear from faculty, you can do this. And who often believe in themselves. So confidence raising, which you heard about, I loved it, in the panel earlier, is really important. I offer to one group, but not both. I just want to rehearse these. There are three levers for raising confidence in people. First, verbal persuasion. Simply tell them they can do it. Secondly, vicarious experiences, that is watching other people do it, vicarious experiences, peer modeling, role modeling, and then last but not least, mastery experiences, allowing them to roll up their sleeves and do it themselves. So with about 15 minutes left in our day, there's our wrap up. I'm gonna ask for our mics to go around and for folks to share, what did you take from the day? What are your takeaways? Why are you here? What do you hear? What do you, you know, sort of expect to do starting tomorrow? And we'll just pass the mic around to get a couple of those in the air and then we'll close out. If you have something to share, main takeaway, you can summarize it, just raise your hand and we'll get a mic to you.
Can we hear me? Hi. My name's Sarah. I'm an English professor here, and I'm adjunct, and I'm what you call a freeway flyer. I teach on average at 4 schools, 6 days a week. And what I took from today was that I'm not alone in all of this. I think that flex days like this are really, really encouraging, especially to people who don't have full-time positions. Knowing that it doesn't matter if you're full-time or part-time, you have something in common with everybody in the room, and to have especially the student panel come up and talk about their experiences. It's not just teachers talking to teachers or students talking to students. There's interaction on both levels, full-time, part-time, student, teacher. I really, that's what I took away from that. So the idea of belonging that you talked about in the beginning, totally solidified today.
Thank you very much. Others?
I was reminded from your speech, John Craig, COS, a recent study of workers in the retail industry, which a lot of our students are, and found out that the statistic was something to the effect of 75% of the time retail workers are notified less than a week when they have a schedule change because of staffing issues, which means a lot of my students won't know until 3 or 4 days before they have to work different hours. And so you reminded me of that, and to the extent of I need to rethink about how strict I am with my scheduling and my missing classes and try to incorporate something like that.
That's wonderful. The statistic,
I remembered it, but then when you gave your presentation, it sort of triggered that.
That's so wonderful. Thank you.
Over here. Just when you said that all the students should be to develop a skill in telling their own story and be proud of it, I think our students, they bring so much to the table, and we have to acknowledge it and have them to be proud of where they come from and have that as part of their education, that we value where they come from.
Thank you. Hand over there.
I was a student here at Long Beach City College, so it's funny because I have my degrees and I've never posted them anywhere I've ever worked. But this time, for some reason, I felt compelled to put my two AA degrees up that I actually have never used. But it's so surprising how when students come into my office, the first thing they notice is like, oh, you were here. And when I see them 2 years later, they come back and say, you know that I got motivated by seeing that I want this on my wall. And it's funny because I hear it over and over again, the little things that we're not aware of our space. So like my office looks like a home. It has a smell of a home. I try to make those things happen in my office. So it just made me more intentional. I'm intentional, but I feel like I could be more intentional in my classes about, I'm horrible with names, so trying to do a little better with remembering names because people want to be seen. People want to be acknowledged. So I even do that when we were at Virginia Tech, there was a campaign about speaking to people when we walk across campus. I speak to students when they walk across campus. They go, oh, do you know me? And no, I just want to say hi, You know, because they're used to not even seeing each other, acknowledging. So just the small things, because we always feel like it has to be something really big, but those small things make a, like they mentioned, right, the students, such a huge impact. So just being mindful of not having to think of big changes, but even small things we can do daily. So that just made me think of that.
Absolutely. And I heard lots of people, heard and saw through some of the glimpses at email, that I think people are sometimes struck by how simple some of these things are. You know, if you're leaving today with any sort of commitment to learning students' names, that is phenomenal. That is probably, if that's your main takeaway, then I'm still very pleased, because it's virtually impossible to feel like you belong in a place where no one knows your name. So learning students' names is one strategy for fostering belonging, communicating care and mattering, which will ultimately increase success, reduce gaps, and fulfill our mission. By the same token, it's hard to sometimes, have you ever, you know, imagine just walking into someone's home. You know, just going down the street to somebody's house, opening the door and just walking straight in. Would you feel like you really belong there? No. Most people walk in and look around like, oh my gosh, is anybody home? Why are we doing this experiment? Strayhorn is crazy. We're not supposed to be in here. We're going to be locked up. Well, many students feel sometimes that way when they walk into the classroom. So another simple strategy for welcoming students into the classroom, starting to build belonging, is to meet them at the door. If you're an instructor who's like really busy setting up stuff like me over here, pressing all these buttons, and students sort of trickle in and they sort of find their seat and they don't really know, and then you greet them, you know, sometimes that's necessary to set up the room. But if you can, meeting students at the door starts to, from the time they walk in, let them know I'm in the right place, the right time, I'm welcome here. Simple stuff. Yes, yes.
First of all, thank you very much. This is one of the most enjoyable Flex Day I did have here, but I just want to second.
Thank you.
I completely agree with you, because I personally do a lot of things that you have been sharing, and I just want to share something with my peers here that I'm doing, and it's very successful, and the students are really happy with it. First of all, I meet the students in the morning with a big smile, and I ask everybody how everybody is doing, and good morning before I start, or good evening. I have to give them the greeting. But it's a very simple thing at the beginning of class, at the beginning of the semester. If you add one welcoming paragraph to your semester, it will make a big, big difference. So let me share with you what I'm writing, and I write this paragraph on my old syllabus and on my landing page on the Canvas. Welcoming the students with my picture and all my details that breaks the ice and make the students feel that I'm close to them and I'm very available. I tell them, welcome to history, Western civilization. I am delighted that you have decided to take this unique course and looking forward to a great semester. I want to stress that I am here for you. Please reach out with me any questions or concerns you may have along the way. You might have questions about class policies, personal issues that might affect your success in the class, or about topics in the class that you want to know about, or you want to know more about. I am here to support your success in the class. My best wishes for a great success. My name and all my details. That made big change in my classroom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wonderful.
I just want to share that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. You know, humanizing the learning environment. I say this on social media, which to me is like my universal chalkboard, that educators should consider practicing vulnerability to the extent that they're, and in places where they're comfortable. To say, you know, hey, if you have personal problems and you want to talk to me about it, I've got, you know, I'll close there. I won't go there yet. Yes.
My comment kind of really jumps off of that. I started the semester almost by accident sharing on the first day that I am a formerly homeless person. I've been homeless twice in my life. I'm also a survivor of assault. And that I have a disability. And so I found that by sharing that, just kind of by accident, my students are more likely to open up to me about their own experiences. So I've had, for the first time this semester in the class where I did share that, I've had a number of students come to me and identify themselves as, you know, having qualities that they would not have told me and had I not done that. And I know that because they haven't told, you know, those around them, even their family members sometimes. So I do want to say that's my big takeaway here. I just thought that it was something that happened by accident, but I'm learning from today that it's not by accident. That's definitely something that I'm going to, you know, continue to do moving forward because I've had such success with it so far. So Thank you.
Hi, I'm Pamela Ennis. I'm in the Human Services Department and the Psychology Department. And I just wanted to share with all of you, the special touch with students as far as their names. And some of these students have some difficult pronouncing names. So what I do is I have them tell me their name and say it out, you know, loudly. Like one girl, her name is Andres, but it's not spelled like Andres. So I phonetically write them. And if I have a student in there with blue hair, you know, I put next to her name blue hair because I make it a point to learn everybody's name in all of my classes. And it's the personal touch because they do come to me with sharing their disabilities or they just open up. But, you know, I make sure I call everybody by their name because they know my name. And I don't care if I have 25 students in the class. I need to know everybody's name, and I address them by their name. So write whatever you need to write by their name. You know, if you can't pronounce it like how they spell it, rewrite it so you can pronounce it correctly.
It's a great strategy. Learning students' names, phonetic learning, and association. Our brains really, you know, learning is an interesting process. It's actually our brain associates stuff. And so you're right. When you say Terrell, tall hair, and you write that there, you start thinking. Now, if you don't practice, because you can't just write it and write tall hair, because then you'll confuse Tyree and me. But you might then practice, you know, saying my name, saying it the right way, as you said, saying the same, using it while you teach or while you work with us. And before you know it, your brain starts to automatically associate Terrell with me, Tyree with him. Yes.
Hi. Hi, so my name is Robin. I'm in the life science department. So our department mostly is serving pre-nursing students. And a couple things I've noticed over my years here. One is, it was mentioned about self-doubt. So definitely one kind of epidemic I've noticed amongst my students is that self-doubt creeps in, and it especially creeps in during testing situations. And I've definitely noticed that in a lot of cases, students will often change correct answers into incorrect ones because the self-doubt creeps in, or they start second-guessing a lot of their answers. So small little kind of antidotes now, I've changed the way I even deliver my tests. So before, I used to just hand them out, all right, good luck, you know, you have an hour and a half, and go do your thing. And now it's like, you know, before I hand out an exam, it's like, I'm very much into yoga, let's take a breath. I also, even just telling them, like, you know, when I'm at home, I promise you I'm not hatching a plan to trick you, but just saying that out loud to them, they're like, oh, she's not trying to trick us, okay. And then I always tell them, don't second guess yourself on the test. You actually know more than you think you know. And so just little antidotes, just, you know, kind of being observant about things like that, the testing anxiety and the self-doubt that creeps in, so.
Wonderful. Affirming students as knowers and as learners. And then we'll have our last comment or question.
So I thought it was doing a really good job on promoting the spirit of inclusivity in my class. I'm really intentional about saying you can be, I teach anatomy and physiology, and I say you can be whoever you want in here. And I always called out the veterans because I thought I was honoring them, like, who's a vet in here? And, you know, and I realized today that's not for me to do. People get to self-identify at their own time, in their own space. And I thought I had it right because I've had a lot of vets. I've even gotten the vet coin. Like, we like you so much, here's a vet coin. But I'm still getting it wrong. So today was really eye-opening for me. As much as I believe in sense of belonging and inclusivity and the spirit of, you know, openness, I'm realized after today that I still have a lot of work to do still.
So thank you for sharing that with us. We will all make mistakes. I think what makes this so worth it is that we are striving to provide equitable learning and achievement, inclusive environments where all students can belong. That does not mean that I remember one time making a mistake. I used a word that my mother always used growing up in my classroom. The word, I just heard it on the radio the other week and I was like, you know, is gypped. Have you ever heard this term, gypped? So I was telling a story and I drew on this language that I remember my mom using, and I remember watching a group of my students just like, they were devastated by me using this, but I had to finish the story. So I was like, oh my gosh, focus on the story, get it done. But what in the world was that reaction about? I put my students on break in the middle of class, and then maybe six or seven students came up to me and said, Dr. Strayhorn, you shouldn't have said that. And I said, what do you mean? And then they educated me on the way in which this word, this colloquial term, you know, demonizes, characterizes a group of people as thieves and robbers. And I was completely unaware. And I remember when I was telling them, I was like, no, I didn't know it. My mom used it. I'm not trying to blame it on my mom, but that's the only reason why it's in my lexicon. I did not know this. And now that I know, I promise you, I won't do it. And they kept saying things like, but you're a diversity expert and you've written books on this and you try. And I thought, and that doesn't mean that I still won't make mistakes. We will all make mistakes. Everybody in here. So if you're thinking that we're going to have a flex day, I talk like I work here, right? If you think that there's going to be a flex day where we're not going to make mistakes, or we're going to finally say, oh, there it is, we all got it, it's not going to happen. But what will happen is we will all have moments where we get better and better. And my grandmother, when she was alive, would say, if you know better, you do better. So I close with this. This is my grandmother's house, that boxy place I told you about earlier. Those of you who know me know that I have
a lot of stories about my grandmother that I could pull and share. My grandmother, I told you earlier, taught me when I was younger that everybody has a light inside of them. It wasn't until one day I was preparing for a keynote and I thought, what is the purpose of education? I looked up the word education in different languages. Education in the Latin is educare. If you look up the definition of the word educare, it means to draw out that which is within. However, if you do a whole bunch of searches on this term, educare, you'll come across one that's nestled in a collegiate encyclopedia or something, and it'll say educare means to draw out the light that's within. And I remember thinking about that and saying, my grandmother was so bright. How does she know that education is all about getting to that light? I remember whenever my grandmother was alive and I saw her, she was always filled with life around me. She filled me with life. When my grandmother suffered an aneurysm, how many of you, do you have a paramedics program or your students go off to be paramedics? So paramedics are special to me because my grandmother had an aneurysm at home. We only knew this because she wasn't answering her phone. She always answered the phone. She would answer the phone like this. Good morning. Good evening. I mean, I don't remember a day where my grandmother was not screaming into the phone. And that was her way of signaling life and energy and vitality. And when she wasn't answering, we knew that something was wrong. So we called for one of my mom's cousins who has a gift for getting into locked buildings. How we're going to characterize that, to go to her house and break in. I meant get into her house. So he goes in, finds my grandmother stooped over her kitchen table, unconscious. He calls for the paramedics. Thank God for paramedics who are well trained. So paramedics come to my grandmother's house. They take her to Craven County Community Hospital. She suffered an aneurysm, and as a result of the aneurysm, they're not sure they can do much for her. She's 88 years old. My mom, who is her only child, calls me and says, hey, Rel, come to North Carolina because Ma has suffered an aneurysm, and you've got to see her. She's in the hospital, and I don't think this doesn't look good. So I didn't believe that because all my life, my grandmother, who was a public school teacher, looked good. My grandmother, who committed herself to the same thing that we all do, education, looked good. So I flew to North Carolina. I went to Craven County Community Hospital. I went onto the third floor. I remember walking up to her room. Her name was on the door, Creola Evelyn Warner. And I jumped in the door and I said, hey, Ma. And the woman in the bed looked at me and then turned away saying nothing. I looked at my mom, who was my grandmother's only child. My mom's a public health nurse. And I went over to my mom and I hugged her. And right as I hugged her, my mom just collapsed into my arms. I said, Mom, you're tired. Go home and rest. She said, I cannot rest. I got to take care of my mom. I said, you don't have to take care of your mom because I'm here. She said, you're not a nurse. I said, no, I'm a doctor. And so my mom went home to rest and I did what good people do, or what good grandsons do for wonderful grandmas like mine. And so I took care of her. I changed her diaper. I cleaned up her messes. I did whatever it was. There are many people who would come to visit my grandmother who would say things that I thought at the time was unkind. They would say, I don't know why she just won't go. I don't know why she just won't go. She knows she's tired. Why won't she just go and let go? And her sister, her only living sister, I remember we call her Martha, Aunt Martha, came into the house and she said to my grandmother, Creola Cree, you can go. And for some reason, all prior to me arriving, my grandmother stayed. I arrive on the 19th. I stay with her the 19th, the 20th, the 21st. I fall asleep with her on the night of the 22nd, holding her hand. I sang the song that she taught me when I was 7 earlier, This Little Light of Mine, but there's another song my grandmother taught me at some point. The words to the song are, there's a bright side somewhere, there's a bright side somewhere. Don't you give up until you find it. There's a bright side somewhere. And I remember holding my grandmother's hand. The nurse came in and said, Dr. Strayhorn, are you going to stay the night? I said, yes. She said, well, I'm going to bring in the cot. I said, I don't need the cot. I don't know why I didn't need the cot that night in my head. But I said, I don't need the cot. I'm going to stay close to my grandmother. I just want to hold her hand tonight. And so I'm sitting next to my grandmother holding her hand. And the nurse leaves. And I drift off to sleep. And then out of nowhere, I was awakened by the most violent shaking of my grandmother's hand I ever remember in my life. I look at the clock. It says 1:19 a.m. on November 23rd. It would have been the 23rd of 2014. Hand is shaking. I look at the clock, 1:19 a.m. I turned to my grandmother and said, Ma, are you okay? And though she had not spoken in weeks, my grandmother turned to me. She lit up. She said, hey, Rail. I said, oh my gosh, she's speaking. She's coming back to life. And I was reaching for the button to call the nurse, and the TV popped on. I'm trying to find the button to call the nurse. And out of nowhere, my grandmother, while holding my hand, said, baby, there's a bright side somewhere. I'm reaching for the button. She said, Rail, sing your part. Forgot about the button. I turned to my grandmother and said, there's a bright side somewhere. Together in harmony, we said, don't you give up until you find it. There's a bright side somewhere. Just like that. While holding her hand, my grandmother took her last breath. When I called the doctor, found the button, he came in, and I will never forget what he said. He said she could go where she had to go because you finally were here. Students can go where they're trying to go because you're here. Every day you show up, I know the meetings might be dry, but if you show up, someone can go further. They can get where they're trying to get. They cannot go. They cannot go without you. They can go when you learn their names. They can go when you provoke them. They can go when you believe in them. They need you. On rainy days, on sunny days, on flex days, and on days when we get far from flexing. Students need you. You make a difference. It's been a great pleasure to be here at Long Beach City College. I wish you the very best. Thank you. Thank you.